Thursday, it must be seen as an extension of our charge to promote the freedom of information, open exchange of ideas. Come on in, have a seat. So while you may not agree with every single thing that you hear in this room today or find in the books on our shelves or on our databases, we want everyone to have wide access to different perspectives so that we can all learn and grow from each other. At the end of this, I'll ask you to fill out a very brief survey asking what you're interested in seeing in the future. We want to keep this relevant to you all. You'll also notice that we have select materials. I know that some folks in Kim's class are going to be working on projects around environment, around climate, right?
Yeah.
Around the environment. And so we have these materials that might be relevant to you all, and we can also help you find other materials if you go to the reference desk and ask the librarian to help you find newspapers, magazines, books, etc. So next week we'll be having a student panel about funding college. But this week I want you to help me give a really warm welcome to Michaela Gonzalez, project manager at Spark Northwest, and our speaker today. Welcome, Michaela.
Thank you all so much for hosting me and for creating this space for constructive dialogue. It's a pretty cool series that you guys are leading. I'm very happy to share a little more information about what I'm working on. Again, my name is Michaela. I work with a very small nonprofit called Spark Northwest. We have about 8 staff people working on renewable energy solutions that are community-based. So we have one person who focuses on policy in Washington and Oregon, and the rest of us work on making sure that renewable energy, particularly solar, is available to people like neighbors or people in rural areas. So my focus is on affordable housing. And helping affordable housing stay affordable using renewable energy technology. Today, I am here representing a coalition of organizations called the Alliance for Jobs and Clean Energy. So my organization is a member and an endorser of their initiative. So today, I will mostly focus on this, although my day job is with Spark Northwest. So you can contact me in both of those ways. I will just share a little story about why climate is important to me personally. I don't know exactly where my passion was born, but I know that since I was a very young child, like 5 years old, I had this poster up in my room of all the animals in the different layers of the ocean. There were like deep sea creatures that like never saw the light of day, and then there was like the middle ocean creatures, and then all the things up at the surface of the ocean. And it just always really fascinated me. I am now really frightened, honestly, about what we can expect in the next several decades and in my lifetime, as how much the climate will affect our daily experience in cities, in natural areas, in the ocean, where food comes from. I'm kind of scared. And for me, being involved in the Alliance for Jobs and Clean Energy is very doable. It's actionable. It's something that I, just by giving a presentation, letting folks know about what they're working on, helps me to feel like there are things that we can do to, one, lower the amount of emissions, address the problem, and then also create solutions for the things that will happen regardless of how much we're emitting. Like, we've emitted enough carbon to do some pretty bad damage, so there are, the two terms I've heard a lot are mitigating climate change, that's addressing the problem, and then resilience, which is how to survive, or how to sustain what happens. Okay, so that's a little bit about my motivations. That said, I am still learning about what their proposal is. One of the great things about the Alliance for Jobs and Clean Energy is it's a coalition of, it is representatives of labor unions, people of color-led community organizations, faith communities, environmentalists, and businesses. And it's a coalition of, how many? 170 partners from the constituent, from it's 170 partners. 170 partners are coming together to create this proposal together, so it's actually changing based on what everyone's priorities are. So it's still changing today. So what I share today might be different tomorrow, and in terms of time frame, there are about two or three statewide proposals to put a fee on how much carbon we're emitting. And this proposal, the goal of this proposal is to get a voter initiative on the ballot in November. Sorry, I'm going too deep too fast. I'm still learning about the initiative, so we're going to learn together. There's a lot of...
Sorry, can you just say what is an initiative?
Oh, what's an initiative?
Hi. I'm sorry, I went to the wrong one.
In this case, it's a proposal that in the state of Washington, you can pass laws by getting your elected officials at the state, like the state legislature, to pass laws, or we can pass it as voters. So you can get, so you get the ballot in November, you can say yes or no, I want to pass it or I don't. So those are two ways to pass laws. There are proposals to get our state legislature to pass a law for a carbon fee, and this proposal is about the one that goes on the ballot. So an initiative is the proposal that gets on the ballot. Does that make sense? Okay. I will hand out some of these, they're like fast facts about our climate, issues in Washington. What I would like you to do is take one or a couple for your table and just read it. If this is new information to you, think about questions you have about it or ideas. If you already know this information, think about how you learned it. Where did you hear it and how do you know about it? And then, so think about that to yourself. And then when I say go, just share it with your neighbor. Tell them what's on your card and share your ideas or your thoughts. Sound okay? I don't have enough for everybody, so maybe take two for every table. If you don't have a partner at your table, come and join another table. Or I can start one here. I'll join this table.
Yeah.
So if you don't know everybody at your table, please introduce your name or...
Alright, so they asked to either talk about why we didn't know it or...
Good question. Eyes up for a second. Take a look at your card. If you know this information already, share where you heard it or how you know about this information. If this is new information to you, share a question or an idea you have about it. Okay.
So
Are all,
Washington. But, sorry, what are your names? Joel. That means?
And we have to talk about it.
And, so this is new.
Shows the clock again, we start, I think.
Also, when I could, yes, but I haven't heard.
One thing that I'm hearing on the radio is about California's wildfires, and it destroyed thousands of acres of forest, and now during the winter time, they're seeing that it's causing landslides because of forest. And you saw a similar situation, I think it was 3 or 4 years ago. You remember there was a landslide on the northern Washington, like the Bellingham area, and they had denuded a forest up there that was above a town, and that whole area slipped and the landslide affected the town up there, and I can't remember the name of it.
Didn't happen like just east of here and
Also, this past June, do you remember? I woke up one day, I opened my door, and it was like ash. That was last July. Well, I live in West Seattle. I don't know if
that's going to happen. It went on like maybe a week and then half a month.
And it was like so hazy. Like in Seattle, like it is not, it's not usual. It's considered a wildfire. So anyways, Would you mind sharing that? That's a big piece of the values and principles of the just transition. You're going to transition to a fossil free economy, and it needs to take into account the economics of the issue. And I'm going to ask folks to share with you guys. Okay, I'm going to come to the top. Everyone take one finish up your thought.
That was quick.
Okay, can we hear maybe one idea or thought or question from each table in any order? Please be brave.
We were talking about, so I think some of us had known
Can
about
I
the
get,
first.
Attention over here, please.
Some of us had heard this first fact, which was intensifying wildfires and worsening health effects due to an increasing amount of money from the state budget. But a lot of us were not aware of the second one, which was that the drought, you know, in I think Eastern Washington led to a loss of 160,000 jobs and, you know, cost the state about $336 million. And we were just discussing how, you know, this impact is very lopsided, you know, especially for people who work in agriculture who don't have a full-time job, and so might not have, like, you know, proper healthcare or housing. And, you know, for them to lose their job is, you know, way more catastrophic, you know, than somebody who works in Seattle, you know, and you know, in this, you know, not agriculture, you know, tech or, like, you know, economy in a different way. So the effects of, you know, all this climate change and, you know, these floods and droughts are very lopsided in terms of people who are suffering because of them.
So our two were 15 of the 16 warmest years were since 2000. And then the other one was in Washington, communities living along our highway corners and industrial areas are more likely to be people of color and or low-income families. And we didn't get a lot of discussion in, but I feel like I'm just gonna have to tell my own personal anecdote, which is that conceptually, I knew both of these things, but not really concretely in a way. Like, I wouldn't have said 15 of the 16 warmest years. You know, I remember seeing the graph of the spiraling temperatures and things. So I guess it's neat to reflect on how many things I conceptually knew about without being able to necessarily cite a specific statistic or a concrete fact.
Rising electricity costs for industry?
Good question. So most of our, actually, I think over 90% of the electricity that we use comes from hydro, which is when we have like a big lake. This is like a cross cut of a lake. So here's the water. And then this is a dam where you stop the water from flowing. Usually, like, it used to be a river and it would flow like that. It used to be a river. When you stop the river from flowing, it creates a lake behind it. So that's we have a lot of dams in Washington State that stops the river from flowing. The water behind it, all of this water comes from snow in the mountains. So up here are the mountains, and they have all the snow. So this snow goes into the water. This water, when it spills over the dam, there's motors here. And it causes the motors to spin, and that creates our electricity. That's where like 90% of our electricity comes from. In Washington State, we have a lot of hydro, which makes our electricity much cheaper than other places in the country. So for example, California and New York, they rely a lot more on fossil fuels than we do in Washington State, so our electricity is actually pretty cheap. When our temperature goes up in the next couple decades, or actually has gone up, right? 15 of the last 16 years have been the hottest on record. So we are now seeing temperatures that we have not seen historically. When we lose the snow that feeds the lakes, then it means less power and it could affect our electricity. That was a good question. Something that I feel like I can understand. Does that make sense?
Yeah.
I just need to teach them.
Any others over here? An idea, a question?
Our topic is wildfires and rising temperatures degrade our air quality and make things like asthma worse. So we discuss a lot this one, and we understand what is meaning because so there are many forests in Washington, which is make our air condition better. So, I have a question.
Yes.
What is the proposed question?
So that's a good point. If we have a lot of forests, what happens when there's a forest fire?
So, the temperature is high. So the forest make pure CO2, but if forest fire, it couldn't work. So
maybe Michaela can explain why rising temperatures create more forest fires.
Yeah. It is easy to burn.
Yeah.
It's easier to burn. So usually, if anyone goes camping, I love going camping, and you drive east on I-90, right, to get to the hikes and all that stuff. During the summer, usually between July and September, they have fire bans. You can't have campfires because when there's no rain, it makes the wood really dry and it can burn really easily. So last summer in July, there were a lot of fires around the Columbia Gorge, down in Oregon, even Vancouver Island, places that are usually pretty damp. So the climate, if it gets warmer, and if we have a drought, it makes the forest more likely to instigate a fire. It's more susceptible to fire. One thing we talked here is that when the forest burns, it creates a lot of particulates, and when you breathe it in, it's bad for health. Anything from over here? One thought, one question?
We got climate change makes our water is too warm for summer. So what would happen if summer was living in the too warm water?
The question is about, so can you read that again?
Yeah, climate change makes our water is too warm for summer. And two, actually for shellfish, three in these industries. So my question is, what will happen if someone lives in too warm water?
Salmon is really important to people here in our region. So salmon is one of the major sources of food for people for thousands of years. Salmon are a really special kind of fish because they make babies in the rivers and then they live their life in the ocean. So they're very particular. We have 10,000 rivers that empty into Puget Sound, and each salmon, the fish, can find out of that. They'll live 2 years in the ocean, right? They're living out in the ocean, they go to Japan, they go to California. When they come back, out of the 10,000 rivers that dump into Puget Sound, they can find the one where they were born as a little egg. Isn't that amazing? When the water is, when the climate goes up and the temperature of their environment goes up, it messes with their biology, much like any other fish, right? If we get too hot, like during summers, I get like, frenzy and I get mad, right? Same thing happens with fish or anything. So it affects the salmon. And one thing that I think that card was pointing out is that the salmon also affects the people. Like, I eat salmon. I know some people fish for salmon and then they'll freeze it, so they'll eat it through the year. So salmon is really important to people here. So I think that's one thing that the card was pointing out. Okay, so, let me see. Can you tell me anything over here? Ideas, questions?
What do you feel like to get a clean energy? What you can do, what we can help to do to get that?
To get more clean energy?
Yes.
Good. I think I can answer that question when we talk about the proposal. Can you just tell me on a scale, here is, I am not understanding anything about climate, please tell me a little bit more, and up to, one is like I understand a little bit more, two is, okay, I understand my facts, and three, I got it, I know all about climate. Good. Ready? So show me, this is, I don't, talk a little more. And three is yes. Let's go. I understand climate, things that are happening because of climate. Ready, set, show me.
How much do you guys understand about climate?
Not anything.
Yeah.
Not a lot?
Not a lot.
If you don't understand this number,
it's a range.
Just you know the limit, this number too.
Yeah.
You know, all the,
you know everything, you're a three.
Yeah.
You know some things, you're a two.
Okay, so I'll spend maybe a couple more slides on climate and then move on to proposal. Sound okay?
Okay.
So climate change, one of the ideas behind each of the facts on your tables is climate change is hurting people and the environment and animals. It's hurting people in Washington right now. It degrades our environment, hurts our economy, like all of the money that is used to pay people to fight wildfires or pay for our electricity. Those are affected by climate change. We also feel some of the worst global impacts of the climate crisis. Hundreds of thousands of Washingtonians have family in places like the Philippines, where my family is from, or India, where typhoons, droughts, and floods kill people. So if there was recently a pretty bad hurricane that hit southern Philippines, that is an impact of climate change. Where climate, as the temperature of the earth rises, it causes more unpredictability and storms to get bigger, or rains that we need to get smaller. It's just unpredictable. So, does that make a little sense? So temperature goes up and it makes it difficult to predict. When does the rain come? When does the snow come? When is the storm coming? How bad will it be? Those go up and down, and it has impact on people, people's lives, and on the and money, and our food, our electricity. So all of those things are unpredictable. One example someone mentioned was the wildfires, right? So last summer we had a lot of wildfires and it made the air really hazy, right? Does anyone know someone that has asthma, like breathing issues, respiratory problems? The folks who have pre-existing conditions are more likely to feel that. If there's something wrong with the air, they're already vulnerable, and so that risk to those folks is higher. So that's some cost to health, cost to our economy. One example was, gets to the question about hydro. So if the temperature goes up, the rain, the storms, all those things become unpredictable. We can't predict how much, you know, water levels to expect or electricity to expect. Another example was the cost to the jobs. It was on this table. Last year, the drought cost the state $336 million. And I don't know exactly where, like, what that money was spent on, but it's related to the cost of droughts to our agriculture, where we farm food, forests, and then the capacity, the people, the need to deal with the problem. So it has a cost to economy workers. Okay. I'm going to keep moving. So, I think the problems are usually clear, and the Alliance for Jobs and Clean Energy is coming up with a solution to fund solutions by pricing the pollution. So the pollution that's causing climate change is a bunch of, it's called greenhouse gases. The largest of those, can anyone explain what a greenhouse gas is?
It's like trapped in, you know, by the atmosphere, like other than the atmosphere.
Can you say a little louder and slower?
So there's some gases which are trapped inside the atmosphere and they, you know, just like inside your car on a hot day, it gets really hot because, you know, sunlight, you know, doesn't escape. These gases are, you know, contained in the atmosphere, and if their density increases beyond a certain point, then it results in a lot of destruction. Carbon dioxide is a greenhouse gas.
Carbon dioxide is a greenhouse gas. So carbon dioxide is one of several gases that have this effect. Like he was saying, if your car is, the windows are closed, the doors are closed on a really hot day, the inside of your car is much hotter than the outside of your car, and the gases in there are keeping it warm. In our case, there's several types of gases. Carbon dioxide is one of the largest components of that, of the greenhouse gases. So the proposal is to put a fee on carbon emissions. Does that make sense? If carbon emissions are causing the problems, we should put a fee on the carbon. Does that make sense? ask a question? Can you ask me a question? Please.
Can you repeat it again?
If carbon dioxide causes the problems that we talked about, the hydro, the forest fires, asthma, if carbon is the problem, the solution is to put a fee, a tax, on the carbon.
Can you explain what a tax is?
Yes. Businesses that if you produce carbon and you put it out into the atmosphere, you have to pay to do that. Right now, there is no restriction. You can put as much carbon into the atmosphere as you want. And there might be some EPA restriction on it or something, not clear.
And carbon is bad.
It's good in small amounts, right? But we have put so much into the atmosphere that it is causing the temperature of the earth and the oceans to go up. So it's so much, it's too much. So the carbon tax or fee is so people who put the carbon out have to pay if they want to produce the carbon. Show me one, I don't understand, three, yes, I get it. One, two, three. Okay, that's good, good enough, okay, great. Okay, price solution. So, where does the fee go? If I'm a company, I'm producing a lot of carbon, right? So, once the fee is in place, I have to pay. I put one ton of carbon out, so then I pay you, the state, $15. But they put out a lot, so there's a lot of money, right, that goes into the state. Where does the money go? One is clean transportation. Oh, this gets back to the question about clean energy and stuff. So one is, clean transportation, what can I say about transportation? In Washington State, half of our carbon emissions come from transportation. So we would want to put that money back into clean transportation. Can someone give an example of a clean transportation option? Bikes! No carbon emissions! It's like your own gas! Perfect. Any other examples?
Buses,
right? It's like 15 or 20 people get to share a ride, and that means like 100. Yes. Good example.
Train.
Say it again.
Train.
The train. Excellent. A lot of our buses and trains are electric. So that means that they're not running on gas, so that's another way to reduce it. So clean transportation. Clean energy. Someone had asked about clean energy. It would also... So my organization works on renewable energy, and we work with a lot of businesses that install solar. They do electrical panels or wind. And so one way to support those businesses is to invest in clean energy.
Do you have a question?
Mm-hmm. Thanks. Okay. Oh, healthy forests and water. If we invest in our forests, it makes them less prone to wildfires that we have seen in the past couple years and in future years. The fund will also be invested in clean drinking water and water reserves for agriculture.
Energy. We talked about clean energy.
key pieces of the carbon fee is that 1/3 of the funds. This policy directs 1/3 of all investments that reduce pollution into communities hardest hit by pollution and poverty. Can someone share, we kind of talked about it at this table, who is hardest hit by some of the issues that we talked about? So forest fires, asthma, air pollution, heat. Who is the most susceptible to that? Kids and older people. Okay, so maybe communities have, there's some communities that have more children, like schools, or communities that have more older people, like senior homes. Who else?
Low-income people and people of color.
Low-income people and people of color. In the US, we've had centuries of policies that put people of color, so brown folks, black folks, Asian folks, into situations and places like communities that they have disinvested in. They put their money into communities where there are more white people. So as a result now, low income people and people of color are more vulnerable to health impacts, or if transportation has, if they, what's another example? We had talked about, in this table we talked about folks who have part-time jobs, don't all have health insurance. So low-income folks or people with part-time jobs might be more susceptible, so those are communities where we want to invest more money as we transition to fossil-free solutions. Thank you. Anyone else?
People from the third world.
People from the third world. So folks who immigrated or maybe are refugees to Washington?
I mean, like, you know, people who live in the third world, even now, you know, like people from India, Pakistan, Philippines, because it's like, you know, the impact is way more, and you know, there are less resources to, you know, rebuild things.
Yeah, that's a good point. I don't know if the state policy would invest abroad. I don't know if there's plans to, but that's a really good idea, which I hadn't thought about. This is their proposed solution, is to tax, put a fee on carbon, and then invest it in clean energy, clean transportation, communities of color and low-income communities, and forests and water. This, I don't understand. This, yes, I get it. 1, 2, 3. Oh, right. Okay, cool. Perfect. What I would love to ask is we need your help. Everyone here, we need your help to help this solution pass as a voter initiative. So I had shared earlier, there's two ways to pass a law. You can pass a law in the state legislature. Those are elected officials in our government. Or we as voters can put it on the ballot so that in November you can say, yes, I want to pass this policy. We have a team that's working on the government-based solution. Right now, we are also working on the voter initiative. In order to get it onto the ballot, we need 350,000 signatures to put it on the ballot. So we're gonna need help starting in February to get a lot of signatures to put it on the ballot. So I had ideas for Leonard here in his class to help us spread word. The way to do that is for folks to understand, right? Like, what is this carbon fee? Why is it important? Why is climate a problem? And how you can help to support if you want to. So what I'll do is, I have two handouts. This one with the green tab is a little bit about the policy. And like I said, the language of the policy, you can find it online, but it will change until the final submission, which I think is at the end of January, maybe beginning of February. But this is an outline. It's the basics. Okay, this is the green one. The yellow one, yes?
I have a question.
Yes?
Okay. Like the people they make carbon usually charge them more, right? For the tax?
Uh-huh.
Okay, they make more carbon. The people they don't make carbon on the other side, if we help them or just, we only increase on this, the other one is just limited.
It's so the question is, do we invest in businesses that don't emit?
Who making carbon and who don't make carbon? Like two, right?
The proposal in the policy is it's by the ton. So if I emit 1 ton, it's $15. If I emit 2 tons, it's $30. If I emit 3 tons, it's 45. So the more carbon, the more.
Who making this carbon?
Businesses.
Cars, right?
Cars. Manufacturers.
Yeah, manufacturers. The one they make a car is special, and the one make an electro, right?
Mm-hmm.
Okay, it's the one they make an electro, we help them, and the other one we charge them on the house.
It would apply to both. So, if a business, say Toyota makes a Prius, right? It's an electric vehicle,
yes.
And they also make a Tacoma. It's a fossil fuel vehicle. And you still emit some fossil fuels to create the electric vehicle.
Yes.
If they create some, even if they're making an electric vehicle, there's a fee on the carbon. On the flip side, the businesses that create the carbon also get some investment to help change their company. Because we don't want the companies to leave, we want their business. So some of the fee goes back to the business to help change the process so that they can emit less. So there's another handout that's yellow. This is about the Alliance for Jobs and Clean Energy.
Wait! Give me your emails before you go!
Oh, they actually have to run off to another class, so.
Oh, no!
Yeah, okay. We end at 12:50, so my students have to.
Thank you all so much for making the time for this very, very important conversation. Grab a sticker on your way out and leave me your email.
Please join me in thanking Michaela. If folks who aren't students want to sign up again, there's an opportunity.